children. Hope all are fine and enjoying this climate. Fine. I hope you people are eagerly waiting for the class. So, today in science, lesson 9, the living organisms, characteristics and their habitats, part 2 we are about to see. So, before going for the session, let's have a recap of part 1. So, in part 1, what are all the topics you have come across? First, organisms. Organisms, what is organisms? So, all the living creatures are called as organisms. And you have come across adaptation. What is adaptation? So, the presence of specific features or certain habitat which enable you to live in the particular surroundings. I'll repeat, what is adaptation? The presence of specific features or certain habitat which enable you to live in the particular surrounding is called adaptation. And what is habitat? So, the surroundings of where plants and animals live is called habitat. Of course, plants have a different kind of habitat. Animals have different kind of habitat. We human beings have different kind of habitats. So, every living creatures have different kinds of habitats. So, in the different kinds of habitats, in our lesson, we have seen about two types of habitat. One is your terrestrial habitat. The other one is your aquatic habitat. What is terrestrial habitat actually? So, the particular organisms, the particular plants and animals which live on land are called terrestrial habitats. For example, grasslands, forest, mountain regions are some examples of terrestrial habitats. And what is aquatic habitat? On the other hand, the plants and animals or the organisms which live on water are called aquatic habitats. So, examples if you take for aquatic habitats, ponds, swamps, lakes, rivers, so sea, ocean, everything will come under aquatic habitats. So, after seeing about aquatic habitat and terrestrial habitat, you have also seen about biotic and abiotic components. So, biotic components are nothing but a living organism. So, living organisms like plants and animals are biotic components, whereas abiotic components are nothing but rocks, soil. So, the non-living creatures we call as abiotic components. And in the terrestrial habitat itself, you have seen about different kinds of terrestrial habitats. In the terrestrial habitats, you have come across desert. So, desert places, how a camel will live, and in mountain regions, what is its habitat? Everything you have seen, children. So, with this terrestrial habitat, part 1 got over. Now, let's move on to the part 2, which starts from aquatic habitat. Today, we are going to see about some aquatic habitats. Yes? So, children, in part 1, you have seen about terrestrial habitats of different plants and animals. So, how these plants and animals are adapting themselves in the particular habitat. So, now we see about aquatic habitat. In aquatic habitat, there are some animals which adapt themselves. So, let's see about that. So, if you take oceans, sea, normally fishes, fish, you know how they will adapt themselves because they have streamlined body which help them move easily in the water. So, there are some animals which do not have streamlined shape. Examples if you take squids and octopus. So, squids and octopus do not have streamlined shape. So, in that case, they will stay deep inside the ocean and near the seabeds and catch prey that move towards them. This is how squids and octopus adapt themselves in the aquatic habitat. Of course, they have gills which help them use oxygen dissolving the water. Yes, and there are some animals which do not have gills. Examples, dolphins and whales. Dolphins and whales do not have gills. So, how they will breathe? They breathe in air through nostrils or blowholes, which is located on the upper part of their head. So, this is how whales and dolphins breathe in air. So, what they will do? So, this allow them to breathe inside the water and they will swim near the surface of water. So, this breathe in air help them to swim near the surface of water, and after some time they will come out, and they have an ability to stay longer inside the water without breathing, and after some time they will come up and again they will go inside. They will come up to get some air and again they will go inside the water. So many would like dolphins. So we do like dolphins very much. We have gone through many shows of dolphins. If dolphins will play just like that, but we will think like dolphins' nature is that. But the reason is dolphins will breathe in air. For that reason only it is coming up and again it is going down. So it can be inside the water for a longer time without breathing, and once it is getting suffocated again it will come out of the water, it will get some air and again it will go inside. This is what the nature of dolphins actually. Many have seen about dolphin shows, so short video of dolphins we'll see now.
The emotional development we see in human babies. Might they too be able to empathize with others?
So children, we have seen about some aquatic habitat of different types of animals. So let's see about ponds and lakes. So in sea, in ocean, what are all the animals present and what habitat it takes place and how it will respirate. So all those things we have seen. And ponds and lakes, if you take, some normal terrestrial plants will grow normally and their main function is to absorb the nutrients and water from the soil, where aquatic plants will reduce in size and its main function is to hold the plant firmly. The stem of these plants are long, thin and light. So this stems will grow up to the surface of water and the leaves and flowers will be floating on the water. So this is how aquatic plants' habitat will be, and some aquatic plants will completely submerge inside the water. So they will have a narrow and thin ribbon like structure. So this stems will help them to grow under the water itself. And if you take frog inside the ponds and lakes, frog have the ponds as their habitat. Frog will live both land and also in the water. So this frog have a long back legs which help them leaping and catching the prey, whereas they also have the webbed feet which help them to swim inside the water. So children, there are a wide range of different kinds of habitats present in this creature, present in the nature, but we have seen only few. But there are lot many examples and there is a wide range of different kinds of habitats present in each type of habitats. So children, we have seen different types of habitats like terrestrial habitat and aquatic habitat. So in terrestrial habitat, what type of habitats like deserts, mountain regions, grasslands, how the plants and animals adapt in terrestrial habitat, whereas in aquatic habitat, how plants and animals will adapt themselves in the aquatic habitat. Fine. So keeping all this apart, let's move on to the characteristics of living organisms. So if I ask you to keep things, you know, so whatever we have seen in different types of habitat, let's keep them apart and just we'll think about the living organisms now. So example, in a forest, if you go near the forest, of course plants will be there, trees will be there, creepers, climbers, yes, mushroom, monkeys, goats, cow, buffalo, lion, deer, donkey, lot of living organisms will be present in the forest. Can you identify which of them are living organisms? Of course, because we know plants are the living organisms. Fine. So keeping this example apart and coming to the non-living organisms, when you look at the things around you at home or near the places where you are, you can easily identify what are the things which is non-living, because we do know living organisms have life and non-living organisms do not have life. So now we are going to compare the living organisms and the non-living organisms. Of course, animals are there, dogs, monkeys, all the animals are living organisms. We do call plants also a living organisms, but plants will not move like a pigeon or monkey or like humans. So it will stand in one place. And how we will identify that plant has living organisms? Because it do respirate, it do inhale carbon dioxide, and it do have a process of growth, everything. So that we call plants as living organisms, and we compare animals also. But animals will walk, animals will look like birds, birds will fly. So we cannot compare plants with this. And of course, clouds, if you take, clouds will move. So clouds are moving, but does it mean clouds are living organisms? Of course, definitely not. So lot many examples are there, but we have in a position to distinguish what is living organism and what is non-living organisms. We may think of, so these are chair, table, everything is there. It is non-living organism. Does it produce any growth? No, of course. But on the other hand, if you take plants or if you take animals, it shows growth. So plant, after some time, if you see, normally it from the height, after 2 to 3 weeks, it shows some growth. So there is a difference between living organisms and a non-living organisms. Of course, vehicles, car, buses, everything is moving, but does it mean car, bus are living organisms? Of course not, children. So the thing is, we are going to differentiate living organisms and the non-living organisms. And what is most common characteristics present in all the living creatures? So if you take plant, plant respirate. If you take animals, animals do respirate. If you take humans, humans will also respirate. So there is one common characteristics present in all the living organisms. That is what we are going to see in our next. Children, so one common characteristics of all living organism is, do all living things need food? Yes, of course, all living organisms need food. Plants, animals, and including humans, all need food. Yes, and plants will prepare their own food in the process of photosynthesis. Yes, so this will depend on plants and other animals for their food. Of course, food gives energy, and other organisms need energy for their life process to grow. Do all living things need food? Obviously, all the living organisms need food, and this is a common characteristic. So the second common characteristics, if we see, do all living things need growth? Of course. So living organisms need growth. So how will you find out that you have grown up? First, I will take you as an example. When you have a dress, no, your beautiful dress which you had 4 years back, will it fit to you still? Definitely not. Some growth you may have. No, size may have grown or height may have grown. Of course, you cannot wear the dress which you had 4 years back. So this is how, children, growth can be made to all the living organisms. If you see a chick will turn into an adult, and if you take a puppy will turn into a dog. And many plants, if you see, when plants, and do you think plants will grow? Of course, plants also will grow. When you see a plant which is very young today, after 2 weeks or 3 weeks, if you see, a plant will also have grown. So this many examples which tells you very clearly about the growth of all living organisms. We can take lot of examples. So first example I told you, when you are a small child, now you have turned to 13, you compare how much you have grown up. And when you take plant, when a plant is very small, and after 2 to 3 weeks, when you see a plant might have grown at least by this size. And when you see a small chick which is hatched from egg, suddenly after some 2 to 3 weeks, if you see, a small chick will turn into a big hen, and a small puppy will be turned into an adult dog. So this is how a growth can be getting used in different types of living creatures. Yes children, and do you think the non-living organisms need growth? Of course. So living organisms need growth, that is a common characteristics. When you compare this to a non-living organism, obviously it is no. Non-living organisms do not show any growth. Fine. Next common characteristics of all the living organisms is, do all living things respire? Respiration? Yes. Think of, can we live without breathing? Of course not. So we will breathe in air inside the body and we will breathe out. So inhale, exhale. We will breathe in and we will breathe out. Yes. So this is the common characteristics human have. When you compare animals, dogs, monkeys and some animals which is very similar to our respiration process. So how we are respirating, same like that, some kind of animals will also respirate. You can watch very closely when they are very slow in movement. You can see dogs, you can see it very clearly. Many have pet dogs at home, right? When it is sleeping, closely go near to them and observe the movement of their abdomen will be up and down, up and down. So this shows very clearly that they are in the breathing process. Of course children, respiration is necessary for all the living organisms and it is necessary for all the living creatures. Yes, and this respiration will completely take all the energy, whatever the food you are taking, this respiration only help you to get the energy. So whatever you are eating, at last from the morning till night you are working or doing something, and finally when you sleep, people will say, no, small children and all, they will eat and they will sleep. They will eat and they will sleep. No, why? Small kids, they will eat and they will sleep. Why this process? Because they will say respiration will make your food to get the energy. So there is a common thing in many different kinds of exchange of gases. For example, earthworms, if you take, earthworms will breathe through their skin. So respiration is common to all the living organisms, but some animals will exchange in the presence of gases, like how earthworms will breathe through their skin. And if you take fish will breathe through gills which dissolve oxygen present inside the water. And if you take plants, of course plants will prepare their own food in the presence of sunlight, but through the leaves, a tiny pores name called stomata. So tiny pores, if you see those tiny pores of stomata will help plants to breathe in. Fine. So plants will have an ability of preparing their own food in the daytime, and it will release the oxygen and it will take the carbon dioxide. So this is how the process, we human beings will intake the oxygen from the plants, and it will, and in turn plants will take carbon dioxide from us. So vice versa. So children, respiration is most common characteristics of all the living organisms. Since they have different exchange gases, but still all the living organisms need respiration. And again I pose a question, do non-living organisms need respiration? Of course not. You have to compare both. Living organisms need respiration for the good health. Of course, non-living organisms do not have respiration process. I've been seeing about the common characteristics of living things which needs food, yes, which needs respiration, which needs growth, and now we'll see, do all living things respond to stimuli? So what is stimuli actually? So some changes which occurs and immediately you are responding to them are called stimuli. Examples, if you ask me, I will tell you, when some sharp objects are pricking in your hand, how do you feel? What happens immediately? Suddenly you will shout. Yes. Suddenly you will respond, oh my god, it is paining. Yes. And when you are shifting from a normal light to a dark light, what happens? Automatically your eyes started shut and again it will open. Yes. So these are all some changes which made you to respond to a particular change. Yes, so which made you to respond is called a stimuli. Of course, if you take animals, animals will also respond to a stimuli. For example, if you have dog, you are keeping some food for dog, immediately what happened? The dog will run and it will respond to a food. Yes, so something, so some inactions it will do. And if you plants, if you take plants also will respond to a stimuli. If you take an example, touch me not plant is there. That is a plant which makes a leaf, a leaves will be small in size, and when you touch the leaf, automatically the plants will close. So this is how the plant has got the name touch me not. So once if you touch the plant, automatically the plant will close. So this is, of course, it is responding to a stimuli. So each and every living organisms will respond to a stimuli, and it is giving an immediate response. Yes, so this is how we call stimulus, and every living organisms will respond to a stimuli. When some changes are occurring and immediately you are about to respond, we call that as stimuli, and all the living organisms will respond to stimuli. Of course, non-living organisms will not respond to a stimuli. So next we'll see about living organisms and excretion. So all the living organisms will take food, but some food can be utilized by the body, but what happens to the rest? So the rest of the food which we are intaking will be taken out through the waste. So plant also will excrete the waste products, and animals also will excrete the waste products, whereas the human beings also will excrete the waste products as the excretion. So the process of getting rid of the waste products which is not utilized by the body, you call as excretion. Yes, children. So the process of getting rid of the waste products which is not utilized by your body can be called as excretion. So plants also do excrete. Plants will also excrete, but little different. So some plants will produce a poisonous materials as waste, whereas some plants will think that can be taken inside itself, it can be stored as a waste on the whole. But some plants will produce a poisonous material inside it. So in this way plants will excretions. So this is how plants, animals and different organisms will excrete. So the living organisms need excretion. Of course, non-living organisms do not need excretion. If you see, do all living things reproduce of their own kind? Of course, if you take a small bird will lay eggs, and small pigeon or small bird will come out of the egg and it will produce it to a young one. And if you take a small dog, and if you take a dog will leave a puppy as their young one. And plants also will reproduce. So how plants will reproduce? So the reproduction process of plant will be taken by germination. So plants will reproduce through seeds. So from seed will germinate and it will turn into a new plant. So children, reproduction process is necessary for all the living organisms to produce their own kind, to produce young ones of their own kind. So living organisms produce young ones of their own kind through the process of reproduction. Next common characteristics is, do all leaves move? Of course. So if you take animals, animal will move from one place to another. But if you compare plants will not move from one place to another. It will be anchored inside the soil. Anchored in the sense, it will be firmly fixed inside the soil and it will stand upright. But it will be synthesized by giving, when it is reproducing their own kind and it is transforming a seed. So all this kind of movements can be given by plants. Of course, plants will bloom, opening and closing movement. So those kind of things you can see inside the plant. Of course, animals will move from one place to another. We human beings will move one place to another. So living organisms, of course, need movement. When you compare in plants, plants will not completely move as how animals and human beings will move. But plant do show movement, like opening or closing, or when a wind is blowing out, it shows some movement, or some activities of movement will be present in plants also. Yes, children, and there is another common characteristics of all the living organisms is to the organisms will die. Of course, when it is when something is growing up, of course, when it is giving birth or when it is reproducing, of course, there is in the other hand, it will die. All the living organisms will have a common characteristics of dying. Yes, so when the living organisms, one side when it is producing its young, on the other side it may also have die. So both the sides of living organisms should take place. Of course, if you take non-living organisms, no, of course, non-living organisms will not have any kind of common characteristics which we have discussed till now. So non-living things will not respire, non-living things will not need food, non-living things will not respond to a stimuli, non-living things will not excrete, non-living things will not reproduce, and non-living things will not show any movement. So a lot of examples we have seen for living organisms, and we have also compared both living organisms and also non-living organisms. And non-living organisms do show movement. For example, car, buses, clock. Yes, clouds are moving in the sky, moon, stars. So star is fixed, but when we see from here, star is like moving, no? So every non-living organisms, if you take example, there is also a characteristics of moving which is very much similar to a living organism, but still it will not be considered as a living organism. It just similar movement it is showing. So children, when you check all the living organisms need everything we have discussed. If you take a seed, when a seed is just being kept in the shop, it will be given for us for sale. For example, moon, if you take, people will buy, they will cook it and they will eat. And instead of keeping this moon in a shop for few months or many months, instead of keeping it in a shop, if you take a moon and if you immerse inside the soil, what happens? Will it reproduce of their own kind? Will it germinate? Yes, it shows movement. Yes, it shows growth. Yes, everything it will do. So this is what actually a living organism is doing wonders in this diversity. When we ask a lot of questions to us, the all type of living organisms characteristics and the habitats will be taken place. So this is all about this lesson. So what then life is? What is then life actually? So life gives very beautiful things which is present in our diversity. So you should analyze, you should absorb things. Yes, so many things are there to observe. You start researching it. So how it is present, when you start analyzing it, automatically the life will be so beautiful to you. Fine, hope this lesson is very much clear to you, and here we'll end up this lesson. So children, we'll revise the questions from textbook in our NOL. What is the habitat? The surroundings where animals live is called their habitat. The organisms depend on their habitat for their food, water, air, shelter and other needs. Habitat means a dwelling place. Second question, how are cactus adapted to survive in a desert? Cactus are adapted to survive in a desert as they have because they no leaves, they don't have any leaves or spiny leaves to prevent water loss through transpiration. And the stem is modified in such a way that it performs photosynthesis and conserves water. Their roots go very deep into the soil for absorbing water. Now, fill in the blanks. The presence of specific features which enables a plant or an animal to live in a particular habitat is called what? Adaptation. The habitats of the plants and animals that live on land are called terrestrial habitats. Next question. The habitats of plants and animals that live in water are called aquatic habitats. Soil, water and air are the abiotic factors of the habitats. Changes in our surroundings that make us respond to them are called stimuli. Number 4, which of the things in the following list are non-living? Plough.
Mushrooms, sewing machine, radio, boat, water, hyacinth and earthworm. So the answer is plug, sewing machine, radio, boat and water are non-living. Fifth question, give an example of a non-living thing which shows any two characteristics of living thing. Example of non-living thing is cloud, which shows following two characteristics of living things. It shows in size, it shows movement. Sixth question, which of the following non-living things were once part of a living thing? Butter, leather, soil, wool, electric bulb, cooking oil, salt, apple, rubber. The answer is butter, leather, wool, cooking oil, apple and rubber are the non-living things which were once part of a living thing. Now, list the common characteristics of living things. Answer. Some common characteristics of living things are growth, movement, reproduction, respiration, responsiveness and excretion. Eighth question, explain why speed is important for survival in the grasslands for animals that live there. Hint, there are few trees or places for animals to hide in grassland habitat. So the answer is, in grassland habitat there are few trees or places for animals to hide. When their enemy attacks, they have to run faster so as to reach a safe place. If they fail, they lost their life. So, the speed is very important for survival of grassland animals. Short answers. What are blowholes or nostrils in dolphins and whales? The organs in dolphins and whales that help in its breathing are called blowholes or nostrils. Explain photosynthesis. The process of making their own food with the help of solar energy from sun, chlorophyll, carbon dioxide and water is called photosynthesis. What is meant by breathing? The process in taking oxygen inside and giving out carbon dioxide, inhalation and exhalation of air in organisms is breathing. What is called respiration? Inhalation and exhalation of air done by the organisms to break down food to get energy, water and oxygen for humans, animals and carbon dioxide for plants is called respiration. Give the differences in the desert and sea regions. In the sea, the water is almost salty and also the animals and plants are covered by them. Mostly, these animals use oxygen that is dissolved in water. In the desert, water is available only in few places and it's hotter in daytime and very cold at night time. The organisms breathe in and out air from the surroundings. How do
camels live in desert?
To move from one place to another place in sand, the feet of the camels designed to have broad formatted large soles which help them in the movement on sand. They can live without water for a long period of time. When water is available, it drinks liters of water in a specific time. They urinate very less and the dung they release is very dry to prevent the loss of water. The broad legs of camel helps in keeping the body warm from the hot desert. Now, seventh question. Give the features of desert plants. The leaves designed in desert plants are either too small or literally absent. Leaves are converted into spines which help to reduce the loss of water. The stems become thick, green and flat which help in photosynthesis. To retain water, the stem is covered with waxy layer. Stem is spongy and stores water. The roots of these plants go very deep into the soil to absorb water. Scientific term, hibernation, long winter sleep of some animals. Adaptation, some features that help an organism to survive in a particular type of habitat. Classwork, the living organisms and their surroundings. Huts, why are the animals living on mountains have thick skin or fur on their body? Thick skin or fur on their body to protect them from cold. Second question, why are the green plants called autotrophs? Because they prepare their own food. Auto means self. Trophs means prepares food. What happens to desert animals like rats and snakes which do not have long legs like the camel? Desert animals stay in burrows during day to keep away from intense heat and come out during night when it is cooler. When a lion jumps, what is the function of its tail? Answer in detail. Explain in detail about the different types of adaptations. What is adaptation? The presence of features or certain habits which help an organism to live in a particular habitat or environment is called adaptation. types of adaptation. There are three types of adaptation: terrestrial habitat, aquatic habitat and arboreal habitats. So terrestrial habitats are nothing but it consists of habitats on land like forests, grasslands, deserts and mountains. Organisms that live on land are cow, horse, lion, camel and tiger are terrestrial organisms. Aquatic habitats. Aquatic habitats include habitats in water like ponds, lakes, rivers and oceans. Arboreal habitats. Arboreal habitats include habitats on trees. Organisms that live on trees like monkeys and squirrels are arboreal organisms.
Children, hope you have understood completely about this lesson 9, living organisms, characteristics and habitat. Hope this video is very much helpful to you. See you in the next session. Thank you.